Alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salam ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Amma ba'da, habita fillah. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Hayyakum Allah jami'an. May Allah tabarak wa ta'ala bless us all with ikhlas wa thabat. I wanted to just highlight some things that I observe. And I see now the trend, the fad, is that all of a sudden Black Lives Matter, at least in as a facade, meaning that this is what is publicized. This is what's the trend. This is the alleged way forward. And what we see, Habitifillah, we see many people who didn't care anything about us before. And I'm not talking about even the Black Lives Matter. I'm not talking about the movement. I'm just talking about you as being a Black person, especially indigenous people in the United States of America, or perhaps Afro-Caribbean in the UK or what have you. That we find many of our brothers and sisters did not care anything about us before. And I recall, subhanAllah, since I've been back in America, a particular brother, may Allah forgive us in him and guide us in him, he greeted me, and I hadn't seen him in years. It was a very superficial greeting, but yet he rushed to the Deobandi imam and greeted and hugged and sheikh. But, you know, it was a very, oh, yeah, you're back? Okay, nice. Yeah, we're doing this. But, and all of a sudden, I see Black Lives Matter all over his Facebook. But we don't see anything that's genuine from a lot of our brothers. I don't care about movements and things like this. I'm talking about Islam. I'm talking about the book of Allah and the sunnah, the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. It becomes a trend, these slogans, but yet your khutbah is in Somali. Yet the new revert that comes in, no one wants to talk to him. No one wants to, they want to make strong and caller because he has an earring or he has a tattoo. They don't know that he just touched down, he just got out of the prison. He doesn't know anything about Islam. He just wants to worship Allah Azza wa Jal. But you don't give him any intention. But you can tell him that he's wrong. You can scare him away from the masjid. This is what I'm talking about, this type of hypocrisy that has to change. The best way forward, Ahabatifillah, because I want this to be constructive and I don't want to spank anyone, is that we need to be constructive in that we need to come back to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Kitabi al-Kareem, that he created as a nation tribes to know one another. And we need to come back what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Kitabi al-Kareem, and that he says, وَاعْتَسِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا. Hold on to you all steadfast to the rope of Allah, and do not divide. Hold on to the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and do not divide. So that means we have to hold on to the book and the sunnah and the minhaj of the salaf. Not on bid'ah, not on this, not on that, not on hizbiyah, not on racism, not on qawmiyah. But we hold on to the book of Allah and the sunnah of the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. And that means we unite based on the book and the sunnah. Wala tafarraqu, and do not divide. This division of habitatillah can no doubt be along tribal lines and racial lines and all the racism and the internal racism, the bigotry we even experience, unfortunately, from even some of our brothers who are reverts. For example, some of our brothers that are white Caucasian Sufis. What's wrong with those guys? Some of those people, they think they're so elite and they're so above others. They don't know how to treat human beings. This goes against the intellect, and it goes against the religion of Allah Azza wa Jal. And that doesn't mean I give a pass to anyone because he's black and he's a racist. But what I'm talking about those who are in power, who have privilege, who have authority, and the way they treat other people. That this has to change, and we have to begin to self-reflect. We have to look as a community to the sickness that we have, and how to deal with it, and how to address it, and how to deal with the hypocrisy. I don't care about your stupid slogans, and I don't care about your stupid Facebook posts, and all this other stuff, when you can't even shake my hand properly as a man to man. You can't even treat my brothers and sisters in the masjid properly. You can't even offer them some knowledge about Islam. Allah favored you with the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be hafiz, and you can't even teach them a class. This is what I'm concerned about. So we have to begin to change the way we see. And this comes with the youth, because the elders are not going to change. The elders are set in their ways. Some of them are migrants from all over the world, and they're already arrogant racist. Plain and simple, I'm sorry. They're arrogant racist. And that is from their own lack of tarbiyah. Reflect. Ponder. Look. We have to begin to correct ourselves, ahabati fillah. I'm talking about myself and you. And as a community, if you don't go forward, how do you expect to be one hand? How do you expect to be successful? You're not going to be successful as the Syrian Refugee Committee. You're not going to be successful as the Palestinian flag bearers. You're not going to be successful as the Somali Refugee Center or the Oromo and Tigray Alliance. But you're going to be successful based on the book and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam. So I invite those who worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who fear Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, who understand what's going to benefit them and their children and provide a better world for them and their children, to begin to reflect on their sins, to reflect on how they treat others, to reflect on their views of race. Wa sallallahu wa sallam ala nabiyyina Muhammad.